This was true on managing food price instabilities to strengthen resilience in agriculture and rural development. I'm now going to give you the key messages, which unfortunately do not give justice to this very interesting presentation and group discussion. It was a very small group, but extremely lively, and the presentations were extremely full of information and new ideas, so it was really great and a lot of new knowledge, especially also for myself. So I'll try to summarize the main messages coming out from this group. Okay, first of all, we said food price volatility has an impact both on consumers in terms of food security and reduced resilience, and also on farmers, because they basically discourage farmers to invest in agriculture. We talked a lot about reconsidering price stabilization as a tool to manage price volatility along with other risk management options. This issue of price stabilization we discussed a lot because there is a little bit of, quite a lot of disagreement in terms of using this, because it has been seen for a long time as a way of interfering with the market. So there are different schools of thought which believe that interfering with prices, with markets, is never good. Markets should be free, but at the same time, at this moment, it is probably the most viable option in terms of stabilizing prices and fight measures against price volatility. There are also other options. In particular, we discussed possibly the ideal option would be to eliminate export bans. What I found interesting in the discussion is that export bans are the main cause of price volatility. And I found it interesting because I thought maybe the speculation in commodity market would be a major cause of these fluctuations. But actually, it turns that these speculations, they have a much lower impacts compared to export bans. And in particularly, we discussed how these export bans, they're used by many countries to stabilize internal prices of food, and at the same time, they create bubbles, like in the financial market. So the other countries, in anticipation for countries not exporting certain food crops, they increase their buying of stocks. So they accumulate stocks. So, and this creates like peaks in prices. So in other words, I mean, these export bans, the WTO, it was said to have it should have a very important role, but it's very difficult that member countries would agree in eliminating these export bans. So for the time being, the conclusion was that price stabilization should be reconsidered as an option, and especially at this stage, the most viable one. And then we also talked a lot about intersectoral coordination on policy and investment responses. And in this sense, it links a little bit to the previous point that agricultural prices, they depend on many factors related to supply and demand. And it is very important to have coordinated policies among all the stakeholders who are involved. In the production chain, and also in terms of investment responses. And this, yes, of course, it's a matter of agriculture and trade, but it's also in some countries, in many countries, a matter of infrastructure, or in some countries, even a matter of security. So in any case, it means that the policies of the different sectors, they have to be better coordinated, and so for investments. Again, as I said, these are just a few messages, but the question, I mean, goes much beyond this. And in terms of what the platform members can do to better understand, assess, and manage food price volatility, well, first of all, we said there should be, the platform could help to promote evidence-based instruments and options to bridge the gaps. Because it seems that there is a lot of evidence about the causes of food price volatility and their instruments to address these, to increase stability. But at the same time, there is a lot of investment in instruments like, for example, insurance mechanisms, which do not seem to be very successful. And this gap, it's it was a very interesting thing, especially like donors who are increasingly investing in, for example, these schemes for insurance or even some other market-based mechanisms, but without really having success stories on these experiences. While on the other side, there is evidence of what other options that could be used, which would be very long to explain in this context, but we had very good presentations on this, and these options should be more looked into. Then we thought that a platform could also help to promote improved governance, transparency, predictability of policy and intersectoral coordination in food price management. And as a third option, policy coherence, which is linked with what I mentioned before, this need for the sectors to better coordinate, to understand the roles, responsibilities of the different sectors, and how especially the role that they could play in managing food prices. And then the third slide on how can the platform members be better at networking and knowledge sharing. Well, first of all, we think that it would be important to have a common position among the platform members about this topic of price volatility. And then to promote more discussion, because it is clear that there is a strong need for more sharing of information about this topic, and also building our internal capacity as members to discuss this and to get into the more technical implications of food prices. And this could be promoted through workshops, e-discussions, conferences, and especially by involving also colleagues of the focal points of the platform members who have more expertise on this topic. And then since the WTO is a member of the platform, we thought that this could be an excellent entry point for making a bridge with them, because in the WTO, food prices and agricultural food prices and food price volatility is now a major concern, and there are a lot of debates, and since trade is a major cause, and has major implication with agricultural food price fluctuations, then it and WTO as a member, and today we said they haven't played such an active role, it could be very interesting to have them participate in this discussion and bring in their expertise on this. So thank you very much, and then I leave it later to my member group colleagues to add on this. Thank you.